Welcome to this service of worship for Clairely Park Presbyterian Church and for all others who are joining us by means of YouTube. I'm so glad that you're here. My name is Pastor Kevin Livingston and I serve here at Clairely Park. This is the second Sunday of Advent as we remember the coming of the Lord Jesus at Christmas. Hear these words as our call to worship. A voice cries, "In the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God." So friends, as we worship today, let's prepare to welcome God's dramatic work in our midst, in our hearts, in our community, and in all creation. Let us worship God.
We light this candle as a sign of the light of Christ. Advent means coming.
We are preparing ourselves for the days when the nations shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore.
The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the cow and the lion and the fatling together. The little child shall lead them.
Let us walk in the light of the Lord.
Sprung of Jesse's lineage coming, as prophets long have sung. It came a floweret bright amid the cold of winter, when half spent was the night. Isaiah 'twas foretold, love aright. She bore to us a Savior when half spent was the night. This flower whose fragrance tender with sweetness fills the air, dispels with glorious splendor our darkness everywhere. True flesh yet very God, from sin and death he saves us and shares our every load. Oh, save your child of man, at last we pray, to the bright courts of heaven and to the endless day.
Friends, let's lift up our hearts to the Lord, giving praise to God in our prayers and acknowledging our sin to him. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, King of glory and love eternal, you are worthy at all times to receive adoration and praise and thanksgiving. We praise you now for sending your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, for whom our hearts wait in this season of Advent. O God of hope, you call us from the exile of sin with the good news of restoration. You build a highway through the wilderness. You come to us to bring us home. Comfort us, Lord, and strengthen us today with the expectation of your saving power made known to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. O Lord, even as you come to us, we confess our willingness to be loved, but also our reluctance to be loved. We acknowledge our readiness to accept your forgiving love, but also our refusal at times to forgive. We confess our eagerness to grasp your offer of redeeming love, but also our resistance to follow you. In this Advent time, O God, forgive us our failure to respond as we should. Come to us anew and afresh, and by your grace, help us to receive you with joy like the shepherds, with gratitude like Simeon, with obedience like Mary, with love as you have loved us. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Friends, hear these words of assurance from Jeremiah chapter 33. The days are coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days, and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. O people of God, Jesus Christ, our Lord, whose coming we celebrate this season, is our righteousness. In Christ, we are made right with God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Dear friends, the peace of Christ be with you. And would you take some time after our service to extend Christ's peace to one another, to a friend or neighbor or loved one.
Long ago, prophets knew Christ would come, born a Jew, come to make all things new, bear all people's burden, freely love and pardon. Ring bells, ring, 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 sing choir, sing, sing, sing. When he comes, who will make him welcome? God in time, God in man, this is God's timeless plan. He will come as a man, born himself of woman, God divinely human. Ring bells, ring, 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 sing choir, sing, sing, sing. When he comes, who will make him welcome? Mary, hail the afraid, she believed, she obeyed. In her womb God is laid, till the time expected, nurtured and protected. Ring bells, ring, 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 sing choir, sing, sing, sing. When he comes, who will make him welcome? Journey ends where afar, Bethlehem shines like a star, stable door stands ajar, unborn son of Mary, Savior, do not tarry. Ring bells, ring, 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 sing choir,
sing, sing, sing. When he comes, we will make him welcome.
Good morning, everyone. Today's scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3-5. A voice of one calling, in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, and the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our reading from the New Testament today comes from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when John saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn, and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Stretch out God.
The title of my message is Preparing the Way. Friends, how do you handle your mail? Particularly these days as we draw close to Christmas, with all the advertising that's sent out to get us to buy a product or sign up for this or that service, it can feel overwhelming. And because we're overwhelmed by the sheer quantity of it, maybe you take all of your junk mail and even without opening it, you just drop it right into the wastebasket. And with the junk emails we receive, we do the same thing. We just hit the delete button. All of us have received those letters that say we have checked you out and you qualify as part of a very special select group of people who are receiving this letter. And we feel very flattered until we examine the envelope and find that it's marked to occupant. But friends, how do we know when we've received something that's really special, that's really personal, something just for us in terms of a message from God? In this passage from Matthew that I've just read, John the Baptist, well, at first glance anyway, appears like one of those preachers we've all seen and heard on the street corners downtown. This is the word of the Lord, repent. The question is, how do you sort out your spiritual mail? The junk mail from the registered first class letter. Or to put it in terms of the internet, how do you sort out your high priority, really important emails from the spam, the unsolicited junk mail we all receive? It's a question we need to ask when it comes to spiritual things. How do we know which messages are from God and they have our name on it? Most of us ignore those people we hear occasionally on the street corners, but John the Baptist catches our attention. Oh, I know. If we saw John in his strange garb and heard his message today, we might not be sure what to make of John the Baptist like one of those street preachers. But John's unusual clothes and diet and his demanding message had a unique God-ordained purpose. He was sent by God to spearhead a spiritual revolution. His job was to prepare people, to make them ready to receive the coming Messiah. That was John's mission, to wake up the world's slumbering conscience and cause people to yearn for a new spiritual order. Matthew tells us in verses 1 and 2 how that revolution came about in very simple yet profound words. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Matthew introduces John as the forerunner, the advance man, as it were, for the good news. He tells us in verse 3 that long, long before, Isaiah the prophet had been speaking about this very man, about John the Baptist, who would become God's messenger and who was preparing the way for the Lord, preparing the way for Jesus. And what was it that Isaiah prophesied? Listen again to what Sharon read for us a few moments ago. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Now, friends, let's remember the context of that passage from Isaiah chapter 40. The Hebrew people had been carried away as captives to Babylon, hundreds of miles from their home in ancient Israel. They were despondent and they were doubting that God still loved them or even remembered them after their constant pattern of turning to other gods and closing their minds and their ears and their hearts to God's word and God's message. So what was Isaiah talking about here? Well, among the nations of the ancient Near East, including Babylon, the pagan rulers would often try to outdo one another with lavish processional parades as they journeyed from one city to another. So this king, this emperor, would go from one place to the next, and a veritable parade would surround him. If you remember that old Disney movie, Aladdin, you'll remember how young Aladdin disguises himself as a prince and he parades into the city with great pageantry, with an incredible array of people and animals. Or maybe something like we celebrated yesterday, if you watched it on television, the Santa Claus parade, with its own music and pageantry and a festive celebration. The ancient kings would do that. They would parade from place to place, making a grand show of themselves, and it was all calculated to show off the king's wealth and splendor. Well, here in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3 to 5, God is bringing comfort to his people by announcing that one day soon, God himself was going to travel across the desert like a conquering king with his people in one of those processional parades. So Isaiah is saying to the exiles that they didn't need to envy the splendor of the pagan processions in Babylon. Their own God was coming soon, and the whole world would see God's glory being revealed. And it was their job to help prepare the way for the Lord. How would God's people do that? His people, it says, will prepare the way for the Lord by building a proverbial highway across the desert, across that wide expanse of arid wasteland between Babylon and the land of Israel, and clearing away all the obstacles. Together, they would cross from Babylon, going back to Jerusalem. The Lord's glory would soon be available for the whole world to see. And did you know that's precisely what happened in 538 BC, some 50 years after Jerusalem had been burned to the ground and the people had been carried away into captivity? King Cyrus began allowing the Jews to return home again to the land of Israel against all the odds, and this prophecy came true. Now, friends, what does Isaiah's picture of God's people returning from exile back to the promised land tell us? What's the prophet trying to tell those who listen to him? It's meant to show us, I think, that the Lord is in control of history. The destiny of every nation and of every man or woman is determined not by luck or chance or fate, not by politicians or generals, not by Donald Trump or Xi Jinping, not even by a virus, or by people working on Bay Street or Wall Street. Our destiny is shaped and determined by the hand of Almighty God, because God alone is sovereign. God is working out his purpose in the events of history on a grand scale and in our lives as well. I love the wording of the old Heidelberg Catechism when it asks the question, what is your only comfort in life and in death? And the answer, what is my only comfort? that I belong, body and soul, in life and in death, not to myself, but to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who at the cost of his own blood has fully paid for my sins and has completely freed me from the dominion of the devil. That he protects me so well, listen to this, that without the will of my Father in heaven, not a hair can fall from my head. Indeed, that everything must fit his purpose for my salvation. So friends, as we look back on our lives, as we look forward into the future, we can be confident like the Apostle Paul, who said in Romans 8, that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. That was the prophet's message to the exiles, affirming the caring providence of God. And that's a word we need to hear again in these uncertain days, in COVID times, for the challenges we face, for the unknown future that stretches out before us. God is in charge. And if you're a believer, then you have nothing ultimately to fear. But Isaiah's words were important not just for the exiles, but for another generation too. Because the Jewish people's return from exile in Babylon was just the beginning of the worldwide revelation of God's glory that he would bring about through the sending of his son, Jesus. And this brings us back to John the Baptist, whose role it was to prepare for the coming, the advent of that Messiah. Though this man, John, who ate locust and wild honey, isn't the type of person we probably have selected for the job, he was God's man. He was God's choice. Remember, as the scripture says in Isaiah 55, God's ways are not always our ways. God's choice of the people he calls for a job to do may leave us scratching our heads, but isn't that God's usual way? As the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, now remember what you were, my brothers and sisters, when God called you. From the human point of view, few of you were wise or powerful or of high social standing. God purposely chose what the world considered nonsense in order to shame the wise. And he chose what the world considered weak in order to shame the powerful. He chose what the world looked down on and despises and thinks is nothing in order to destroy what the world thinks is important. This means that no one can boast in God's presence. I mean, who would have thought that a young man from the backwoods of North Carolina who'd never been to seminary would become the greatest evangelist the world has ever known? Billy Graham. Who would have thought that a little tiny woman who stood 4 feet 10 inches tall in her shoes from a remote corner of Eastern Europe, working selflessly with the poor in the slums of Cairo, in Calcutta, India, would have such an enormous impact on the world's conscience? Mother Teresa. That's the paradox of faith. God uses what seems insignificant to do very significant things. God uses people who seem insignificant to do amazing things. So with this in mind, let's take a closer look at this man, John the Baptist, that God selected to begin his spiritual revolution. Look at his appearance in verse 4. John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locust and wild honey. Now, friends, that meant he spent his days out in the desert. Can you imagine how he looked? how he smelled? I don't think John would have much sympathy for some of us who pack our suitcases full of clothes and cosmetics and our blow dryers for our hair every time we go on an overnight trip. Spending most of his time in the desert, his appearance was probably disheveled and unkempt, his skin leathery, his face worn by the scorching sun and the blasting winds. He probably looked more like the panhandlers we meet on the streets than like us. But in his own strange way, John was an arrow pointing to Jesus. And that's exactly what John was created to be. John not only spoke like a prophet of God, he looked the part. His rugged, austere message perfectly matched his rugged, austere lifestyle. And unlike many of the religious leaders, John lived by the principles he espoused. He had integrity. He had character. He practiced what he preached. But friends, this integrity John had is what God wants from all of us. Although we aren't called, I don't think, to walk around in camel hair tunics and eat insects, we are called to be like Jesus with the people around us. And that means that we should live what we believe. It's exactly what the Apostle John writes in one of his letters. In 1 John 1:6, he says, "If we say we have fellowship with God, yet at the same time are living in the darkness, we are lying in both our words and our actions." So that was John's appearance. But secondly, look at the impact he had. Look at verses 5 and 6. People, it says, went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John appeared without any fanfare, yet soon he gained widespread popularity because of his unique preaching and his unusual practice of baptizing people in the Jordan River. In fact, this kind of ritual, this baptism that he was doing, was normally reserved only for Gentiles who were converting to the Jewish faith. John must have shocked his fellow Jews by requiring that they too receive that same kind of baptism. In effect, John was saying that they needed the same kind of repentance, a change in heart, a change in the direction of their lives as the Gentiles did. Thirdly, look at the conflict his message stirred up when people listened to what he said, verses 7 to 10. Many of the people did change their ways and responded with heartfelt obedience. They repented. But other people, especially lots of the religious leader types, were offended and scandalized and angered by what John said. So John turns to them with scorn and accuses them of being hypocrites. Listen to verse 7. When John saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And don't think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children of Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." You know, if they'd had newspapers back then, can you imagine the bold headline when they reported on this guy John and what he was saying? "Desert preacher slanders local religious leaders, calls them snakes." But John, you see, was making an important point. Just because you're born Jewish, because you're part of Abraham's family tree, that doesn't guarantee you salvation. Only genuine repentance and heartfelt faith could do that. Repentance goes far beyond just feeling guilty for our sins. It means changing the way we think and behave. There's a story about two men who were out fishing on a Wednesday evening up at one of their cottages. "You know," one man confessed, "I feel guilty being here on the night we have our prayer meeting back at the church. Our pastor's trying so hard to get people to attend, and as elders, we probably ought to be there tonight." But his other friend responded, "Oh, I couldn't be there even if I was home. My wife is sick." You see, like the Pharisees, that man felt guilty, but not guilty enough to change his behavior. The great Scottish preacher James Stewart once said, "It's much easier to spend a dozen hours discussing religion than one half hour obeying God." My friends, to repent means more than just take a dip in the Jordan and have a spiritual experience. It means to change our lives. As a spouse, as a parent or grandparent, as a roommate, as an employee, as a boss, we are to put our Christian beliefs into practice, not just give verbal assent to them. If our response to God is real, it will impact the way we think and the way we speak and the way we treat other people, the way we give, the way we use our time. Repentance may begin with a sorrowful heart, but should always end with determined action. Finally, look at John's announcement in verse 11. You see, the heart of John's mission wasn't just calling people to repent, but it was announcing to the world that the Messiah was coming. "After me," John says, "will come one who is more powerful than I am." He's talking about Jesus. Living in the desert like he did, John must have been a pretty tough guy with considerable physical strength, but the coming Christ would surpass John's natural power. He would demonstrate an inner strength as God's chosen Messiah. And John says that this Messiah would be greater than he was. "I'm not fit to carry his sandals," says John. In those days, the rabbis had disciples perform all sorts of menial tasks and jobs for them, except the removal of their sandals. In Israel, in John's day, there were no sewers, of course. You can imagine what waste of humans and animals filled the streets. It was unthinkable that anyone else but a lowly servant would handle your sandals after a day spent walking around in such conditions. But John says that the one who is coming is so great that he, John, is unfit to perform even that lowly task for him. And John says that Jesus was holier than he was. "I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." John washed people with water, but Jesus would transform people on the inside, making them pure and clean again, flowing with rivers of living water. Underneath the surface, our world isn't really all that different from John the Baptist's. And there's two things that stand out to me from this passage. First, the presence of John the Baptist in the salvation story teaches us that among God's faithful people, there should always be some mavericks and rebels. John was a maverick, not so much because of his diet or his clothing or even his words, but because he dared to live out his God-given convictions. And in a day of moral compromise and mediocrity, we need men and women who will go against the grain and stand up for what they believe, even if it makes them look like a maverick or a rebel to those around them. And secondly, John the Baptist reminds us that among God's people, there are still hypocrites. The Pharisees and Sadducees, for all their criticism of John, they stayed and listened to his message. And who can deny that in the body of Christ today, we have our share of hypocrites? Guess what? I look in the mirror at one every morning. Who of us have not felt hypocritical at one time or another, when the way we behave does not measure up to the faith that we profess? But friends, that's all the more reason why we should pray and ask the Lord to help us to be authentic followers of Jesus, the genuine article, living proof that Christ makes a real difference in our lives. With John's ministry, the curtain was about to go up on the greatest drama creation had ever witnessed. It was about to see the coming of Jesus, the Messiah, the Lord, who came as the very presence of God in human form, walking the face of this earth, healing, helping, forgiving, and announcing God's salvation to all who would trust and believe. John's essential work was to point us to Jesus, the one who alone can give us hope and light and life. Let's pray. Gracious God, take these words that have been spoken in your word and from the prophet Isaiah and from Matthew's gospel, and drive their point home to our hearts. Lord Jesus, come into our hearts today. We receive you anew and afresh, and help us to live as followers and as disciples of yours. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Waiting. The action of staying where one is. Time passing. Expecting something to happen until one day it does. Advent is a time of waiting, of hope, of anticipation. God tells us in Galatians that when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son. Advent is the church in waiting, the church's yearly reminder each December of what Christians worldwide anticipate in the days before Christmas. We wait for Christmas as Israel waited centuries for a Savior, for God to fulfill his covenant. They waited for a virgin son to Abraham's line, a descendant of Isaac, Jacob, and David, for a branch from the rod of Jesse, for a baby born in Bethlehem, called Emmanuel. For generations, God's people waited for the fulfillment of countless Old Testament prophecies of a Savior who would light this world brighter than any Magi star. Jesus was the long-awaited hope to a dark and sinful world. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. As Christians wait for the light of Christmas, the four Advent candles are lit with each week's passing, and blue decorates the altar to receive our King with hope. But we know that our hoping and waiting doesn't stop at Christmas, because he's coming back on the last day, a second Advent. So as we hope for Christmas, we continue to wait and pray for our Savior to come again.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the Lord that we celebrate this Advent season. They will come from the east and the west and from the north and south and sit at table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites all who trust in him to share this feast that he has prepared. Friends, the Lord be with you. And let's lift up our hearts to God and offer him our praise and our thanks. Let's pray. O Lord, our God, creator and ruler of the universe, you formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. You set us in this world to love and to serve you and to live in peace with all that you have made. And when we turned away from you, you did not turn away from us. When we were captives in slavery, you delivered us to freedom and made covenant to be our sovereign God. When we were stubborn and stiff-necked, you spoke to us through the prophets who looked for that day when justice shall triumph and peace shall reign over all the earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the celestial choirs and with all your faithful people of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You sent him into this world to satisfy the longings of your people for a Savior, to bring freedom to the captives of sin, and to establish justice for the oppressed. He came among us as one of us, taking the lot of the poor, sharing in human suffering. We rejoice that in his death and in his rising again, you set before us a sure promise of new life, the certain hope of a heavenly home where we will sit at table with Christ our Lord. Remembering your gracious acts for us in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this wine and joyfully celebrate his dying and his rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Great is the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place, as this bread is Christ's body for us. Send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Strengthen us, O God, in the power of your Spirit, to bring good news to the poor, and lift blind eyes to sight, to loose the chains that bind and claim your blessing for all people. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your people in the joy of heaven. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, forever and ever. Amen. And now, friends, together, let us pray the prayer that Jesus, our Savior, taught his followers to pray, singing together. Disciples, saying, "Take, eat, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Every time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the Lord until he comes." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Receive them with faith and in gratitude. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of God's benefits. Eternal God, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you fed us with this spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and his blood. Send us now out into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Now, friends, go from this worship service in peace to love and to serve the Lord this Advent season, and receive his blessing. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen. Thank you.